Hi everyone, and welcome to this video on bodies of water. There are many different ways we have classified various types of bodies of water, and we'll discuss the most major ones in this video, as well as a couple fun ones too. Like the boiling river that may or may not exist. Let's start with the big ones, oceans. Composed of salt water, they cover 70% of the Earth's surface, and in reality are one world ocean that we've broken up into five smaller divisions. They are, in descending order by size, the Pacific, Atlantic, Indian, Southern, or Antarctic, and Arctic. These are what we might term political or horizontal divisions, rather than physical or biological vertical divisions. Since the 1700s, there have been many allusions to some sort of Southern Ocean, and recently, attempts have been made to formalize the Southern Ocean, given the importance of ocean currents. The Southern Ocean has the strongest and longest current in the world, which circumvents Antarctica. Next up in size are seas. A sea is also made up of salt water and is a large body of water entirely or partially surrounded by land. This isn't to be confused with the sea, which is generally how people refer to the collection of oceans. It's a matter of specificity. If you're not being specific, you might take a holiday by the sea. If you are being specific, you might sail across the Mediterranean Sea or the Pacific Ocean, but you wouldn't go to the Pacific Sea. A few seas would be the Mediterranean, Bering, Norwegian, Arabian, and so on. You'll notice that these are often just bits of the ocean that are mostly surrounded by land that we've named. The Caspian Sea is sometimes classified as a salt lake, although it's quite large. Now, before we move inland to talk about lakes, let's first discuss wetlands and deltas. A delta is where a river meets the ocean, or sometimes the lake. Usually the river fans out as it approaches the sea level, as you can see in these photos. They formed when a river carries a certain amount of sediment at a high rate, and when it reaches a stagnant body of water, it forms a delta. Now, a wetland is different from a delta, although wetlands often form near the shore. Wetlands form unique ecosystems that are inundated by water and contain an especially high degree of aquatic plants. Wetlands have been considered the most biologically diverse ecosystem in the world. Okay, now back to more traditional bodies of water. Lakes are next largest after seas. A lake is always landlocked, meaning it's completely surrounded by land, except for a river that feeds or drains the lake. Apparently, scientists can't decide on a specific differentiation between lakes and ponds, so generally we go by size. Lakes are bigger. It depends on who you ask, but some people will say that a lake is a body of water that's more than 5 acres in surface area. Others will say it's 99 or more acres in surface area. Almost exclusively, lakes are freshwater, unlike seas, bays, harbors, or anything else that's made up of salt water. Lakes are formed for different reasons. Most often, lakes were formed, we think, by retreating glaciers that carved up the land. Sometimes they're formed by the movements of tectonic plates. If you want to learn more about tectonic plates, check on our video on them right here. Now, a fun type of lake is the Oxbow Lake. This is formed when a meandering river, which usually occurs in a low-lying plain, bends back on itself, forming a U, or horseshoe. The edges continue to erode and eventually the stream meets itself again, and the running water bypasses the loop and continues on the shorter route. This leaves the water in the loop to form a lake. You can see an excellent example of this in this photo of a river in Iraq outside Baghdad. But oxbow lakes occur all over the world. In Australia, they call them billabongs. Still going down the list in size, we have ponds that are next. These are freshwater and are often man-made. They're formed in a variety of different ways and include koi ponds and other aesthetic purposes, as well as uses for farming. Of course, there are many other types of bodies of water, such as fjords, wadis, runs, subglacial lakes, reservoirs, lagoons, kills, etc. But sadly, we don't have time to talk about all those right now, so you'll have to go research them on your own. But I promised you I'd talk about the boiling river. Legend has it that when the Spanish conquistadors went into the Amazon rainforest in search of gold, few returned. Those that did told horror stories of man-eating snakes, diseases, dangerous creatures, and a river that boiled. Hundreds of years later, a young Peruvian named Andre Russo grew up hearing these tales and was determined to find this river. He eventually worked for National Geographic and would spend years researching and talking to locals about the boiling river. Mostly, he was laughed at for chasing old legends, but eventually, deep in the rainforest, he finally found the boiling river with the help of the local guardian shaman. So, yes, it does exist. Although, boiling is a bit hyperbolic. It is, however, huge, extremely hot, quite long, and non-volcanic. It's classified as a thermal river and isn't actually any hotter than other thermal bodies of water. I hope this video was helpful. I'd love it if you hit that like button and subscribe. If you're prepping for a big test, we have a study guide that may help you pass that test with flying colors. Check out our website for more information. And as always, happy studying.